Aside from the way you look this morning, that sunshine is a beautiful sight outside this morning. I'm glad to welcome you to the Holden Beach Chapel. We've come together once again to worship the Lord. Thank you for choosing to be here this day. If you are a visitor, maybe this is the first time that you have visited with us here at Holden Beach Chapel. If it is, we want to make sure that you feel like that you are at home. So if this is your first foray here to the chapel, would you simply raise your hand so that we can acknowledge your presence, give you a family heirloom to take home and that little yellow sticker, and give it to your children and grandchildren. We're glad to have you here. And of course, for the rest of us, be sure that when you see that little smiley face, that you make sure that they feel like that they are indeed home. We're glad to welcome you and thank you for being here this morning. Let me call your attention to a couple of announcements. They're in your bulletin. Tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, the men's Bible study group will begin once again. It's a 10-week study on the book of John, the Gospel of John. And it will be for 10 weeks. It'll start at 8 o'clock here in the room over here to the side. And it will be led by our own Dr. Harold Wright. So all the men are invited. Please come, and if you can, it'll be a wonderful study. And then the ladies didn't want to be outdone. They're starting the Sterling Women's Bible Study will have a class beginning September the 9th of Who Do You Say That I Am? A question that all of us at one time in our lives must answer. So that will be meeting at 9 o'clock on Thursdays, beginning September the 9th. Ladies, if you want to be a part of that, please call the church office with Denisa so that you can register for that. And then for our second helping, that has been a wonderful summer. They collected over 1,200 pounds of food once again yesterday. For those of you that are not aware of it, when people are leaving the beach on Saturday morning between 7 and 12 at the Beach Mart, if there are groceries that you bought, thinking that you were going to chow down the entire week and you have things left over, please, rather than throwing it away, drop it off at the Beach Mart, because there are those who could use that and it will be a blessing to you and certainly for them. We're glad that you're here today, and we are prayerful that you will experience the presence of the Lord in your own life today. If you look in your bulletin, may we read responsibly our call to worship. I am the Good Shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. My sheep, I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will ever snatch them out of my hand. May we pray together, please. Father, you have taught us to pray for one another, to give thanks for our blessings, to confess our sins, and you have taught us how to pray with prayers in the scripture, and the prayers of the saints that we have heard, and in the prayed lives of all faithful people. So we ask that you hear us as we turn to you. When we ask for things wisely and in faith, we pray that you would grant our petitions. When we ask for things that are foolish, we ask that you be kind to us. When we omit obvious things that we should be mentioning in our prayers, fill them in, Lord. When our deepest felt words offered to you are really between the lines, listen carefully to us. For ours is not a praying age, and we regretfully are not a deeply praying people. Hear our prayers of thanksgiving for all the good things in our lives, for strong ties of human caring, for families that are very close, for people whose quiet humor clears the air, for those people who are enthusiastic about life and all that is decent and fine, and even for that gift that is rare, that gift of common sense. We know, Lord, that our very best is still flawed and incomplete. We confess that we are more concerned with our physical illnesses than our spiritual illness. Forgive us, Father. and enable us that we might walk more humbly in your ways. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, hymn number 13, All Glory Be to God on High. Please grab a hymnal, stand as we sing together. Back cover your hymnal is the Apostles' Creed. May we recite it together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In whatever way you feel comfortable, now greet those that are around you and let them know that you're glad that they're here in the house of the Lord.
Testament lesson today is Ephesians 4, 25 through 5, 2. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who is stealing should no longer steal. They must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, on this beautiful morning and in this beautiful place, we ask for hearts of gratitude. There's so much to be thankful for, especially the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And this day, we honor him with worship and prayer and music. We thank you, dear God, for your faithfulness, goodness, blessings, and ability to bring hope even in the toughest of times. You strengthen us with your great love and care. Help us keep our eyes and hearts set on you. We love you, need you, and praise you this day and every day. In Jesus' name we pray his prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
Turn your hymnal now to hymn 570, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Please stand.
Oh,
May we pray, please. We bring our tithes and our gifts and our offerings to you today, Father, with enthusiasm and dedication. We ask that you would help us shed any reluctance or doubt we may have in bringing our gifts to you, lest our hesitation sabotage the privilege of worshiping you and in turn rob us of our joy in giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. It's my privilege today to introduce to you Dr. Mike Garrett. Now, Dr. Garrett was here a couple of years ago, but then last year, the pandemic got in the way and he was not able to make it, but we're happy to welcome him back this year. As you can see, a graduate of the Union Theological Seminary in near Richmond, Virginia, and also the Columbia Theological Seminary in Georgia. Happy to welcome his wife, Marcia, down this week, and we apologize for the weather. It can't always be lovely, but it's still the beach. And, you know, the worst day at the beach beats the best day in the city. So we're glad to welcome him here. And so at this time, Mike, the service is yours.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Bring you greetings from the First Presbyterian Church in Fayetteville, North Carolina. Many of those folks are active participants here at the chapel, though I don't see my cheering section out there this morning. But that is fine, because that means I can talk about them freely and not have to worry about the implications of doing that. Always thankful for an opportunity to be here with you. It's certainly been a wonderful invitational damn week at Holden Beach, and it's been very, very good to be with you. As we continue our worship today, I want to bring you a lesson from Matthew's Gospel. And of course, the moment I said that, I shut the Bible and pulled the bookmark out right where I had it. The 11th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, following Jesus in his ministry. And as usual, if you give Jesus enough time, he will manage to get himself into some trouble. And that appears to be happening in Matthew's Gospel as he begins to run into some opposition. Folks who are questioning what he's doing, not as receptive to what he has to say. I'll begin reading at the 25th verse of the 11th chapter. At that time, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." My friends, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Father in heaven, for your gracious word, we give you thanks. For an ancient word that forever lives, we give you thanks. And now, may it speak to our hearts that truth we most need to hear. We make our prayer in Jesus' name. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. If you stretch that together, it will fit very nicely on the side of a turbus tumble, wouldn't it? And if you're going to go spend a week at the beach, to me that would seem to be just the right verse. Give us a little bit of rest. I have yet to see that at one of the beach stores along the way. Surely someone is missing an opportunity, unless they come up with. We like the idea that God is in the business of cutting tired people a break. And we need to think that because we would love to believe that God is more than a perpetual responsibility machine, that God is more than a divine to-do list or an eternally unrelenting cause's business we must be about 24/7. So when Jesus utters this gracious invitation to this ancient listening crowd, he gets our attention to it. It wasn't just an old word for long gone people. It's a living word for present people. Is God not the God who will cut us a little slack and give us some help? And I think the answer to that is yes. But Jesus' simple, gracious invitation, like most things, it's not as easy as it looks. I don't know what to say about being weary these days, except that I am, and I suspect in some way you are too. There is a weariness in the land to which none of us are strangers, and we feel the weight. Much is contested. We are tired of viruses that don't seem to want to go away. I won't remind you or repeat the headlines day after day. You know them full well yourself. There is much frustration around us and the meek who endure the world's injustices. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, the merciful, the pure in heart, the peacemakers, the persecuted. Jesus is saying that these are the little people. The people who care simply and deeply for what God cares about. Those are the little ones. And if you have a sense today that you might be among the little people, and it makes you careful, and it makes you weary in your soul, then know that Jesus has an invitation for you. Because the wise never pay attention to his invitations anyway. Come to me, all of you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Is Jesus' invitation for you? Well, if it is, I think you already know it. You've already heard it. It's already found a place in your heart. It is calling to you like a rain shower in a drought. It is flowing like a stream in a desert. It is like a shoulder that someone offers to you when you're bearing a burden and you just can't take another step. To those who feel the weariness of being careful, Jesus offers us the opportunity to be refreshed, to rest. But let's talk about that rest for a minute. If the rest that Jesus is offering you and offering me is more lasting than a lazy day at the lake or a wonderful week at the beach, what is it? What is the rest of God? How does it come to earth? For so often it seems like a cloud. Clouds look so substantial. Until you put your arms around them, and then it seems as if they're not there. You know, Scripture almost always describes the place of rest as the place where God is. To ease Moses' fears about meeting his people on a journey through the desert wilderness, the Lord says to Moses, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Rest in Scripture becomes a picture of salvation. It becomes a picture of God's gift in our lives. It's the destiny of the whole world. There's a beautiful picture of it in the book of Psalms. I'm sure you've heard it. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. There is that rest. Matthew's gospel begins by telling us the word, telling us about Jesus. The words of Isaiah the prophet, that Jesus is God with us, the presence of God. And Matthew's gospel ends, not just with a great commission, but after that with these words. Jesus speaking, "And surely I am with you until the end of the age." Once again, the presence of God. God is a God whose presence gives rest, and we're invited to share it. And here is the problem, and that's what we need to work out today. I think Jesus was telling his first listeners that their religion, as good as it was, that some of their followers, some of their co-religionists had turned that faith into a system of rules, into a system of regulations, into a system of evaluation that was preventing a deep and simple connection to the God of Israel. For all that it was doing, there was not enough rest to be found. And when there is no rest, it is a weary, burdened life. And I think he's warning us, those of us who believe in a faith that we have come to call Christianity, that we need to realize that when Christianity becomes a name simply for our favorite rules, for our favorite causes, that it becomes a shorthand for our causes and crusades, well, it too ceases to be a thing of rest. It is no substitute for a simple and deep connection to the presence of Christ. For you see, apart from that thing, apart from that core, the connection to the presence of Christ, Christianity is a religion without spiritual power. It is a recipe for moral improvement without the main ingredient needed to improve. And it can become a wearisome choice. the main thing the main thing? If not, I suspect we are tired. And if we are tired, then we need to learn how to take Jesus' invitation to rest before our religion turns into a sinkhole, which looks okay on top, but is dangerously lacking support in the depths of the wheel. To the weary, to the little children, the little people, the ordinary people, Christ offers rest. And yet, in the next breath, he seems to cancel our vacation. He offers his work. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. And this is where simple Jesus is. This is simple after all. You know, the yoke in Jesus' day was a body of religious teaching. A faithful Jewish person took on a yoke. A yoke, the yoke of Torah, the teaching, the commandments of the Old Testament. And here's Jesus saying to us, I want you to take my yoke upon you. He wasn't throwing out the Torah, but he was filling it out, and he was filling it up. So what is this yoke? What are we supposed to learn? Well, here's the long answer. The long answer is go home and read the Gospel of Matthew. The shorter answer is read the Sermon on the Mount from chapters 5 to 7. Here's just a little of it. You know not the murder, but I tell you, living in anger with your brothers and sisters is no better than that, and it will cost you your life. You know not to commit adultery, but a life consumed by lust isn't any better. You know the saying, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, but I tell you not to resist an evil person. You've heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. That is the old covenant filled up and filled in by Jesus. It is simple. It isn't that the problem, because it is not easy. At first glance, hardly restful at all. And yet, at the very core of what it means to be a believing man or woman, why would Jesus invite us to take a rest and then give us a yoke? Well, perhaps because there is no life without a yoke. There are simply yokes that chafe and yokes that fit. And if we're to live well, we need to make sure that we pick the one that fits and not the one that chafes, the one that was made for us by God. But there's more here to Jesus' teaching than that. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, in Jesus' day, a yoke was an agricultural tool, right? To put an oxen in a yoke to pull your plow. But most yokes had two places. the poise of Jesus for our weary selves, he invites us to slip on